Greetings, everybody, and welcome back once again to Valkyrie Profile. As I mentioned previously, I've been doing a little bit of work off camera to prepare for this episode and the upcoming section of the game, which is Chapter 7. As you can see, we are now at period 28 out of 28, meaning that when I leave the Sunken Shrine this time, the chapter is going to end and we'll enter the Sacred Phase. A number of people had requested in the comments of previous episodes that I show in battle some of the Einherjar we've not yet had an opportunity to use. So to that end, and simply because I like him, I've gone to the trouble of leveling up Gray in the interim between episodes. I'm also going to be leveling Jun in Chapter 7, and probably a few of the other Einherjar as well. My goal, ultimately, is to be able to show all of them off in battle, and even though I've sent a bunch of them up to Valhalla already, I'm going to be getting all but one of them back when I get to Seraphic Gate, and memory does not serve 100% on this, but I might even get most of them back when I enter the penultimate sequence of the A ending. Maybe even the B ending, because I think what I'm going to do is get the B ending first just to show what it looks like, and then reload that save file to get the A ending. I might already have mentioned that, but it would have been a while ago and I've forgotten. So, Gray is all set to go. I actually, by farming the Crimson Edge, the Lance, from the ropers in the Sunken Shrine here, I was able to save up enough MP to buy a third Grom already, and I think I'm going to be getting a fourth one either at the end of this chapter or at the end of Chapter 7. I think it might be Chapter 7. I'll keep my eyes peeled. If we get a weapon at the end of this chapter, then it'll be this chapter, but if not, then it'll be Chapter 7. Another thing that I've done, and I'm going to cut to some off-camera footage here, is I have leveled up Jail, basically maxed her out, and prepared her for Valhalla. I actually sent her up a couple of cycles ago, and I had to do that before the last visit to the Sunken Shrine, because if I did that with 26 periods consumed already and only two remaining, then I would not have had an opportunity to send her up after leaving the Sunken Shrine now, because I would have gone immediately to the Sacred Phase and not had time to conduct the transfer. So I sent her with, I think, four periods remaining, as you're seeing here. All of her skills are maxed. She has the best equipment that's available at this point of the game. So she's basically ready to go to Valhalla. She's all set, and I sent her up then. So all that remains now is for us to exit the Sunken Shrine for the final time this chapter, and enter the Sacred Phase. So let's see how things played out in Asgard while we were busy farming materialized points in the Sunken Shrine.
It has been a long time, Leneth. Our current situation is as follows.
We're sweeping them.
Our current situation is, our forces are routing the enemy. If things continue as... Do you wish to know the status of our Einherjar?
Because it totally wasn't our Einherjar who were entirely responsible, these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 people, entirely responsible for turning the tide of the war in Asgard.
You wish to know her status?
Let's see how they're doing. Search for artifacts, basically on patrol, merging with 3rd platoon, so... yeah, things are heating up in Asgard. Subjugation of the Fire Dragon. Okay. This is probably the only thing worth reading here. Muspelheim, wow. The land of flame, volcanic peaks stand like rows of spears, and inside lie caverns ancient and deep. It is said that the fire dragon Fafnir sleeps in the deepest part of the cave.
The cavern entrance leading to Jotunheim is sealed with ice.
Okay, yeah, so the idea here is that in order to initiate Ragnarok, and defeat Surt, the king of the fire giants, we have to break into Jotunheim. But apparently the entrance to Jotunheim, as Freya tells us, is sealed with ice. We need some way of breaking the seal.
In order to break that seal, you must take the accursed flame gem from the dragon, Fafnir.
Okay, yeah, I'm sure he'll just hand it over without a fight.
Defeat Fafnir and retrieve the accursed flame gem.
Both the first and third platoons entered the swirling cave of fire to retrieve the accursed flame gem from the terrible clutches of the mighty fire dragon, Fafnir. Dead. Not big surprise. Okay, so this bothers me, because Fafnir is a fairly important figure in Norse mythology, and as far as Valkyrie Profile is concerned, he just unceremoniously dies off camera, and we never hear about him again. That's it, just dead in a cutscene. Which is partly hilarious to me, but also partly a huge disappointment.
Do you wish to know the status of our...
Because come on, he would have made a great boss. But I guess they ran out of room on the discs, or time for development, or budget for development. Who knows?
You wish to know his status?
Inspection of spoils, transfer of prisoners, in the abyss. Interesting. Also, his hero value is utterly astronomical now. Murin Caves. The Murin Caves connect Garm Island with the Ceteris continent. A vital transport route, many units have been lost there. Investigations suggested that a demon was lurking within the caves. Apparently, Queen Hel of Niflheim has sent the demon there. After much consideration, Thor and the others have decided to deploy the second platoon to subjugate the demon and make the cavern route passable again. And I guess we subjugated the demon.
Do you wish to know the status of our...
I guess the upshot of all of this corner cutting is that we don't have to spend half the episode in the sacred phase.
You wish to know his...
Llewellyn, useless little Llewellyn, finally made the top rank of 10th level god. Wow, and special training. I wonder if that was, a private one-on-one session with Frey. Cause, you know, the Norse gods would totally do something like that. Transfer of supplies to friendly platoons, merging with the first platoon. Oh, he was part of the third platoon, so they merged. And he was actually involved in the subjugation of Fafnir. Wow. Well, good for you, Llewellyn. You've exceeded everybody's admittedly bare minimum expectations of you.
Do you wish to know the status of our
Llewellyn is unironically a true hero now.
You wish to know her status?
It's all thanks to all of the huge getting that we did. I could have worded that a little bit better. Transfer to Kual region, search for artifacts, patrolling of Fort Urser, elimination enemy unit. Okay. A Vanir Special Forces unit infiltrated Fort Urser and sabotaged it. It has fallen to the Vanir army. Why would they sabotage it if they were going to capture it? The 4th platoon patrolling near the area receives a message from Valhalla via codec. Because, you know, we have those in Valhalla. Our base, Fort Urser, has fallen to the Vanir Special Forces. They destroyed the fort and annihilated our troops stationed there. There were also many artifacts stored at the fort. They must not fall into their hands. The 4th platoon is the closest unit. Get to Fort Urser and destroy the enemy before they can flee with the artifacts, so that Lenith doesn't steal that shit. You must save those artifacts. Oh, okay, well, I guess it wasn't a total loss. What the hell? We'll try this and hope to God it's just not Thor again. It's Thor again. Oh well, that's what I get for trying.
Yes, good. I like Yolanda better.
Do you wish to know the status of our...
How is Yume doing? This is another one that even Leneth didn't have faith in. 10th level god! Wow! These children really did go far in Valhalla after all, didn't they? Surprise attack on Kidtha Hill. Major role in ferocious attack. Spam that great magic, Yume. The 5th platoon has captured and bound a Vanir officer. While transporting him from the fort to Valhalla, they were met on Kidtha Hill by the Vanir army, who had come to reclaim their commander. They've come to take back our prisoner. They won't find it so easy. Keep the prisoner at all costs. Yes, sir. Oh, and we transported the prisoner. And we don't even see Yume involved in that cutscene. Just the generic nameless jobber Aesir. Alright, whatever. It's fine.
Do you wish to know the status of our unhappy?
How about Jail? She's the one I just sent up, so let's see how she fared in the evaluation. Not bad! 15th level god right off the bat, pretty good. Searching for artifacts, on patrol, immediately merging with the third level, the third platoon, rather. Precise preparations! Subjugation of Fafnir, of course, because she's a badass like that. Attack with perfect accuracy, spot monster's weakness, and exploits recognized. Great, let's see what this is all about. Jail is engrossed in preparations for tomorrow's battle. The last thing Shad does is check the edge of her sword. Oh, Japan. Good, sharp as a razor. She will serve me well, as usual. Jail seems like one of those classic overachievers to me. Also, it irritates me that she's shown with green hair in her character portrait, but blonde hair in her battle sprite. Oh well. So I guess tomorrow's battle was the subjugation of Fafnir. Yeah, I would make damn sure my sword was properly sharpened too before a fight like that.
Do you wish to know the status of our
And finally, our good buddy Lucien.
You wish to know his status?
How is Lucien doing? 10th level god. Wow. Ordered on special mission. Oh, and he was part of the attack on Kidtha Hill as well. Attack with perfect accuracy, spot monster's weakness, and he loses 10 points for discovering a wounded soldier? All right. Let's see what this is all about. So I'm supposed to... Oh, of course! Of course they make him clean the storeroom. Yes, that's right. It's a lot of work. It won't be easy. Don't worry, I can do it. Lucien is ordered to clean the storeroom. He applies himself to the task with gusto! Yeah! I'm gonna clean this storeroom! Phew, I guess that's it. Well, it looks like you're done. An impressive job! You have my thanks. Takes even trivial tasks seriously. You know what? Good on you, Lucien. I remember when I was washing dishes at a pizzeria. It sucked. But even I took that trivial task seriously. Alright, let's see. What lost you 10 points, Lucien? How did you screw up here? We've got it under control now. Huh? What the? Lucien's unit attacked the Vanir base and successfully brought it under control. While investigating a nearby forest, he notices a person hiding in the shadow of a tree. Who's that? A Vanir. Wounded, eh? Go ahead, kill me. Run. Huh? I told you to run away. If you're caught, you'll be killed. You are merciful. I think that will be your death someday. Actually, I think something very different will be Lucian's death someday. Perhaps. If fate desires, now hurry and run. Wow. Yeah, okay, so Valhalla was understandably not pleased with his decision here. I understand. Okay, well...
Do you wish to know the status of our Anherjar?
I think we're done here.
Leneth, about your performance. It is magnificent!
You have been doing an awesome job of stealing every artifact in Valhalla. Odin's closet is suspiciously empty, and he has no idea why.
These are all the materialized points I can grant you at this time.
It gets me every time.
The Lord Odin is pleased with you. He bids me give you these artifacts.
Okay, we have not been awarded a weapon this sacred phase, even though we've achieved the highest possible evaluation. So I guess our opportunity to get another Grom is going to be during the next sacred phase instead. It's a shame, but goodness knows I've got three of the damn things already. I don't think I really need a fourth. I see that I've also gotten the Wand of Exchange, which is actually a very helpful item. It rearranges enemy positions so that enemies in the back row are dragged to the front row. So it's very good for getting rid of mages you wouldn't otherwise be able to hit with your physical attackers. Other than that, not really anything good. A Tome of Alchemy, an Aether Scepter, which is useful even at this point in the game, which just goes to show you how broken it is in Chapter 1 and 2 when you first start getting your hands on them.
Leneth, I have a request to make of you. It seems the accursed flame gem which can remove the ice seal is broken.
God damn it, Fafnir! You gave us a broken accursed flame gem! These things don't just grow on trees, you know.
There is someone in the Forest of Spirits who can repair it. We must repair the accursed flame gem before the attack from Jotunheim begins. Leneth, I'm giving the accursed flame gem to you to hold.
Great!
Bring the accursed flame gem to the Forest of Spirits and have it repaired.
So this time Leneth was given a special mission.
I have heard that Niflheim is engaged in some suspicious activities. I do not think they will attack us anytime soon, but in any case, please send us an Einherjar who is knowledgeable about the undead.
Can do. Also, I don't think I've explained this before, but the necessary hero value for each chapter is a hard minimum. It means that you cannot send anybody up to Valhalla who does not have a hero value of at least the specified number. So, what it means is that maxing out their traits is not just a storyline thing, where you level up their traits such as brave or nimble, those things. You actually have to do a certain amount of that before Valhalla will accept them, because any character whose hero value does not meet the requirement Freya specifies cannot be sent, even if they would otherwise be eligible, which is, it's people who are not exceptions like Arngrim or Mistina.
We need sorcerers. Send us someone skilled in the art of magic.
Now, they say someone skilled, but they also specify here high-level sorcerer. And there is a particular character they have in mind, whom I think Odin himself is actually going to step in and tell us about in a moment. But I don't want to send her. We'll talk about that in a second here.
Hundreds of years ago, there was a sorceress who feared her own power so greatly that she took her own life.
Odin is a huge asshole, but his VA is right on point.
Some say she inherited her power as a prophecy from Mimir, the ancestor of the Vanir. Her name was Lyseria. Even with her death, her soul was not allowed to die. It is sealed inside the crystal of a massive magic gem.
Imagine how much bonus experience that gem would give me.
The ruins where it is sealed are called Arcane by the Midgardians. Lenith, you must go to the ruins and free the sorceress Lyseria's soul.
Very well. Good fortune.
So, Lyseria is the one they want this chapter. However, there is a most unfortunate bug where...
I expect good news.
If you send Lyseria to Valhalla, you will never get her back. So I'm going to send Larenta instead. And now... now we find our confirmation that we are indeed getting the A ending. So after this, it does not matter what we do or how we do it. We can swipe artifacts freely. We don't have to worry about our evaluation. We don't have to worry about our seal value. We don't have to worry about any of it. Because this cutscene is the guarantee that we did things right. Also, it's interesting to me that there are poisonous weeping lilies in Asgard as well. Are you all ready for the best line in the game? Are you ready for it? Here it comes. Incredible! You can't hide anything from you. Best line in the game. So here, Frey finally pries out of Lucien what's on his mind. Unfortunately, this is the point in the game where the dialogue really begins to become very stilted. And I get the sense that they might have rushed the localization from this point. Because the translations from the original Japanese are really not so great in quite a few of the cutscenes from here on out. But what's basically going on is that Lucien has confessed to Frey his feelings for Lenith and the fact that she resembles his old girlfriend, Platina, whom at this point it is blatantly obvious was Lenith already in human form. And here Loki indicates that he's about to leave, but he doesn't. And Frey says this as though she's speaking to Lucien, but she faces Loki. So again, it's kind of unclear what exactly is transpiring here. Whether she's speaking to Loki or just speaking to Lucien while turning her back to him in the typical JRPG fashion. But to a native English speaker, this translation sounds very unnatural. And Frey is totally cool with that. She's like, yeah, no, your feelings for Lenith are nothing to hide. It's cool. And Frey proceeds to tell Lucien pretty much everything about Lenith, including what would have been, if we weren't already aware of it, some pretty big plot bombshells. And again, these translations are not great, but the idea is basically humans reincarnate after death, gods live forever, and the undead just never die, so they're basically immortal and they're free from the flow of time. And again, although it's not clear, this is Frey telling Lucien all of these things. And now Frey gives away probably the biggest piece of information that just screws everybody over. Just straight up confirms, yeah, no, Lenneth has no memory. Freya sealed that shit. I always try to get her to talk about her human life, but it seems that my sister Freya has sealed off her memories. Oh well. Oh yeah, don't tell Lenneth about that. She'll be super pissed. And at the very least, Frey is also decent enough to provide a somewhat reasonable explanation as to why that is. Her duty as a Valkyrie is primary. If her human memory remained, she would have too much empathy for humans, and she wouldn't be able to properly fulfill the role that Odin set her to fulfill. Oh, oops, maybe I said too much. It's not like they needed a convenient plot dump. Loki's not falling for that. Oh, well. Loki's like, hey, Frey, you just said it yourself, but you talk too much. Shut up. Okay, well, those of you who know who Loki is and who understand his role and the implications of it in the original Norse mythology will already know what's going on here, but for those who don't, Loki is kind of an asshole. He is primarily known as a trickster, and he is responsible for the death of at least one of the other Aesir, leading up to Ragnarok. And that being the case, here he sees an opportunity to take advantage of the vulnerable Lucien, who is clearly wearing his heart on his sleeve. What will you do? So here Loki explains what the water mirror is and how it works. This is what Odin and Freya use to communicate with Lenneth during the sacred phases. And for those of you who've played Valkyrie Profile 2, you might take this opportunity to compare and contrast the water mirror room in this game with the one in Valkyrie Profile 2. Because they're pretty damn close. That's a good question, Lucien. Probably not. Odin will probably be extra angry with you. And Loki, at the very least, is honest enough to say, yeah, you know, I don't care. You could die for all I care. It's not my problem. If you think about it, you can't really believe anyone would punish you for something like using a little mirror. You know, Odin's personal mirror that he uses for important Odin reasons. He totally won't be extremely angry with you about that. Oh, Lucien, you gullible idiot. Also, that thing there is the dragon orb.
Valkyrie, do you hear me? It's me, Lucien. Valkyrie, do you hear me? Valkyrie.
What happened here? You think I will forgive you for taking such liberties?
I know you won't, but...
Lucien, what is this?
I'm going to send you one of these earrings, and I want you to take it. But the other one is hidden somewhere else.
What do you mean? That's why you used the water mirror?
It wasn't really the earring that I wanted to give you. But I thought if you accepted it, maybe... No. I know that you'll figure out where the other earring is.
How will I? You dare to order me to go treasure hunting? You're a fool. Now that you have done this, have you any idea of the repercussions? This was unforgivable.
Why did it have to come to this?
You made a dumb choice, idiot. And now Loki has the dragon orb. Which is probably not great. And now Loki shows his true colors. Shit's going down! Okay, so just before we wrap things up, I want to talk about that too, because that bothers me a little bit. Throughout the course of Valkyrie Profile 2, they make a very, very big deal about the fact that without the Dragon Orb, Midgard will basically collapse, and everybody there will die, because the Dragon Orb's power is what sustains Midgard's existence. But apparently for this entire time, the Dragon Orb has just been sitting in Asgard, where, according to the plot of Valkyrie Profile 2, it would have caused Midgard to collapse. I'm not 100% sure they totally thought that one through. Just saying. And on that note, I am going to wrap things up here. So thank you all very much for joining me, and I look forward to seeing all of you next time. Take care, everybody.